Welcome to the Sri Lankan Understanding, a platform on which we explore the past of Sri Lanka, we look at the present, and we look at the future of an island in the Indian Ocean. Our topic of discussion today is living in a COVID-compatible world. We've invited a senior medical professional who has served around this country, who's had his education in Pakistan and in Sri Lanka, and is currently the director of the Medical Technology Services Centre at the Ministry of Health. Dr. Anwar Hamdani, thank you so much for taking time to join us on the Sri Lankan Understanding.
Thank you very much for inviting me for this.
When we look at COVID and its evolution in the last 24 months, we've seen several changes that have taken place, from processes of quarantine to processes of vaccine. Can you tell us some of the main highlights in the last 24 months, how this has evolved in Sri Lanka in particular?
Let me start like this. I think you, as you very correctly said, it's almost nearing for about 24 months. The first patient whom we identified in Sri Lanka was a foreign national on the 31st of January 2020. Then from there onward, the local patient whom we identified was on the 17th of March. So we had to develop processes because this was an kind of unprecedented event that the Sri Lankan health system, or rather the Sri Lankan public, faced. So we came up with solutions, we came up with suggestions, but initially we started up with like getting all the positive patients into stations, where we started with 25 beds at the IDH. As of now, we have 38,895 beds in 275 stations, which is quite easy to tell, but it was a daunting task. Then again, initially we started up with, you know, quarantining all the first contacts. We took them in, we sent them into stations, quarantined themselves, then released them. It was a process of unknown kind of. We were actually following countries which had been doing this, which had experienced this kind of waves before us, what China was doing, because it was initiated on the Wuhan province in China. So we were actually following them. Then later on, we are experts in the local, you know, setup, the local context. We identified it should be tailor-made to what we need. So we as a country, who's roughly having a GDP about 80 billion right now, with all this crisis. So we were planning like what we could do, what we could afford, what we could accommodate. So we were thinking on that line. So as of now, you know, the whole scenario has changed. Now, if you wish, and if you fall into that category of, you know, people who are above 2 years, below 65 years, and who has all the facilities at home to get yourself quarantined, even if you are tested positive at home, you are allowed to do so under the medical supervision. We have a special line care 1390 which caters that. Then again, if you are a person who has comorbidities, who is vulnerable, I mean, this is quite, you know, common in all part of the world. What we see is the vulnerable population were at risk, were at high risk. So we were actually catering them. So get them into stations, get them into quarantine centers, get them into treatment centers, treat them, look after them well, give a quality of care. That is what is mostly needed. Not that you just provide care, give a quality of care. So that is how we have come up to this stage up until now. As of yesterday, the death rates were 23 and the total positivity rate was 746. So this is ranging in that area, about 600 to 700, where we even experienced at the highest peak, which was 5,400, 5,900. So we feel relaxed. That is what this is normalized. That is what you feel, the things are normalized, things are moving in. You feeling relaxed about yourself. You're just getting all around yourself is because of what we have achieved. So this is an evolving process. You never know what's going to happen next. Even developed countries than us had to lock down countries for more than 100 days. Why? They initially locked down, lifted, again they locked down. So now they've understood the process of locking down does not contain the disease greatly, until unless you figure it out.
Because when we talk about what the pandemic has done, it has altered lifestyles. People have had a revolutionary change in how they live their lives on a daily basis. Are we ever going to see a return to a pre-COVID period? Or are we going to have to live in a very different world in the years ahead?
I would rather use this term, new normalcy. I mean, this is quite a fancy term, like, there's nothing called new normalcy. You're getting into normal life. But this is going to be new normalcy because it is something very new which you haven't experienced. Wearing a mask and walking down the street is going to be new normalcy. Maintaining 1 meter distance is going to be new normalcy. Not overcrowding in enclosed environments is going to be new normalcy. So what I would like to tell is, like, see, this COVID has caused a lot of damages, which we can categorically say into a lot of aspects, but people look into a very narrow aspect and say it's a health problem. Yeah, you will have pneumonia, you will have chest infections later. I'm just putting across the medical terminologies. You'll have, you know, heart issues, you'll have blood clotting issues, you'll have neurological issues. These are all health problems, long-term health effects. Who's going to pay for it? We. The patient has to come back to a government institution. He'll have to pay for it. We, all of us, have to pay for it. Then indirectly, there is an economic cost of it. So invariably, it affects the economy as of now and in future. And which has eroded public relations, which has eroded human relations. The face-to-face interaction, the face-to-face, you know, communication has lost. So all these effects, socially, economically, politically, and culturally, has caused a lot of damages and will have loads of impacts in the future.
Absolutely, and this is where we are going to have to be prepared for that. It's a mindset, it's a change that we've got to adopt whether we like it or not. When we return on our next segment, we're going to look at experiences outside of the country and the lessons that can be learned here in Sri Lanka and what measures are being taken in this particular process. When we return on the next step segment of the Sri Lankan Understanding. Welcome back to the Sri Lankan Understanding. We're in conversation with Dr. Anwar Hamdani, and we're talking about life in a COVID-compatible world. Dr. Hamdani, when we look at other countries and we're looking at a relative degree of normalcy or adaptability in many quarters of the world, they're opening up, their tourism is booming, their countries are continuing to function, economies, people are going about. Maybe lockdowns and things are part of the past for them. In some countries it's not the case, but lots of countries in the West have probably moved into the next phase. What are some of the lessons that we can learn? What can we take to Sri Lanka from those situations, those countries?
That is what actually we were also forecasting and doing things. Like, as of the current rate, what you take out of the deaths, see, we have neared about 14,000 deaths. Out of that, roughly about 70% are unvaccinated. So one might think, okay, another 30% is vaccinated and dead, so why should I get vaccine? Out of that 30%, 22% are single dose vaccinated. Only 8% who has got both the doses and completed the 14-day period of developing the antibody had unfortunately died. But this is not to justify things. Then again, with that statistics, that 8% has comorbidities like non-communicable disease, diabetes, pressure, kidney disease. See, what does this say? Why do those countries which has opened now, imagine the United Arab Emirates has opened for tourism, and doing well. Why aren't we yet there? It's because of us. We did not abide, we did not adhere to what was told. Very simple answer for this is get yourself jabbed, get yourself vaccinated. Now, what we did was, we started checking out the production brand, the country of origin, and is this A category of vaccine is better than the B, or B is better than the A or C. So we were searching, we were spending time on that. When those countries were getting their, you know, population mopped up with vaccine. And that is where we fail. It's our duty. See, at the end of the day, as health or any other regulatory authority, any other law enforcement authority, we could provide guidelines, we could provide protocols, we can enforce things, but who has to follow? You just don't become a leader if you don't have followers. So simply, if, including me, if we do not follow the rules, regulations and the guidelines, we would not reach anywhere. If I don't follow, the house doesn't follow. If the house doesn't follow, the society doesn't follow. Then invariably the country falls down. It's our responsibility to take it up. So the lessons what we could learn is from the developing or the nations which have succeeded on this is vaccination, 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 discipline, discipline, discipline. These are the key two messages I think that we could learn from those countries, how we can, you know, build up our nation.
I mean, connecting it to that, certainly as a developing country, we're also very heavily reliant on tourism, on exports. We're reliant on these industries functioning. And that is where there was a massive debate on whether to have a lockdown, the impact of the lockdown, whether it is a daily wage earner or whether it is a large-scale garment producer. There is going to be an impact. We have got to accept it, whether we like it or not. But these kind of situations, I know we've taken measures to overcome them. During the lockdown, industries were working. Everybody wasn't at home. There were measures that essential services had to continue. Are there other measures that can be taken in such situations in order to deal with such a development where we have the economy functioning whilst we also make sure, I know there's discipline has to come off, that has to come from the people. I mean, we saw that at vaccination centers where people weren't even willing to put their piece of cotton wool into a dustbin. You had to throw it on the ground, you had to drop it. It was a mass of, it had snowed in the vaccination centers. I mean, and there you had the people cleaning it up thereafter. But what else can be done? How do we instill this?
Let me take it on this ground. When we had the second wave on the 4th of October 2020, where you rather call it as the Minwangoda cluster, people name different clusters in different names, but I always call it the second wave or the third wave. So when it came up, we were actually facing a bit of economic crisis, and invariably we were forced to go for a lockdown. Within about 20 days we went down on lockdown. So what happened from that lockdown, we had to extend that lockdown for about 90 days of a period where everything was shut. But that is the time where we learned from the others how to create bubble concepts. The key economy workers or the key worker concept was introduced, where we could actually utilize the key worker concept. Not that everybody becomes a key worker daily. Today you might be a key worker, tomorrow you're not. There'll be somebody else. So everybody was given that opportunity of coming up within the bubble to work, carry out their duties, where does the economic functions also been carried out, and it doesn't curtail anything much. So that was an experiment done during that wave, and which was very well practiced in the third wave, because by then most of the people were vaccinated. And we very well decided, see, our economy basically, as Dr. George, what you told very correctly, our economy basically runs through the tourism, and the apparel sectors. So within these two sectors, we basically got all the hoteliers and all the apparel sector people vaccinated as early as possible. So this gave an assurance for the Western world, the overseas travelers who are intending to come to Sri Lanka, gave an assurance, and that is why we are in the green zone now. So this is how we could actually function, because for years to come, the COVID is going to be there. It's going to be there with you, so you'll have to live with it. It's all what you need to know is how you're going to live with it. Either you accommodate yourself in a context where you believe and you walk through that COVID is there and you will protect yourself in order to protect the country, you walk through that frame, or else you just carelessly behave anything. Whatever happens to me is all right. So it's up to us, like, how are we going to put it forward? So we have this key worker concept has to be maintained for the years to come, otherwise we will fall into an economic crisis.
Absolutely. When we come back on our next segment, we're going to look at the psychosocial impact, and we're going to return to the individual who matters at the end of the day. When we return with our next segment of the Sri Lankan Understanding. Welcome back to the Sri Lankan Understanding. We're in conversation with Dr. Anwar Hamdani, and we're talking about living in a COVID-compatible world. Dr. Hamdani, from a psychosocial perspective, how concerned are you about the impact that the pandemic is having on individuals, families, communities? Because whilst they are the ones, you and I, individuals, will make a change, you and I are also affected by it. From a psychological perspective, how concerned are you?
Let me start with children. I mean, this is what people actually are looking into. I think children have not attended school for almost about a year and a half. Beginners, people who have attended and then stopped, then people who had been in the verge of, you know, deciding their life, deciding their future, and all these things have come to an halt. So this is going to greatly affect in the future, whether we like it or not. So I've been noticed and I've been informed by certain specialists also. Now the greatest threat runs through children is screen addiction. They're addicted to the screen. Now most of the things are done in Zoom, so they're addicted to the screen. So they don't come out of it. So the normal day-to-day human touch, human connectivity at home is lost, which a child needs mostly when developing. On their milestone development, it is an essential component that you make interaction with your parents, with your siblings, with your friends. So that is how you develop a human, that is how you develop a man, a woman, who comes into society to produce something better. Now, this is lost. This is going to greatly affect the children. So this part has to overcome. Now we've started as the Ministry of Health, we've started certain psychosocial, you know, supporting systems, you know, counseling systems. We've individually deployed people to schools as soon as the school starts to have a separate subject for a week to improve yourself. I mean, there are certain people who have even, you know, thought of suicides. I was planning my A level this year. I was trying to do like this, and I wanted to become a doctor or an engineer, an accountant. But I couldn't complete all my things what I wanted in the way I wanted. So useless life. So that part has to be overcome. That is the psychological factor for children. Then again, the daily wages. The daily wage workers are greatly affected, which eventually affects their home front, which eventually affects their whole family. from the little child who doesn't understand anything, why father is not going to work and why aren't we having food to eat? That is a marginalized community whom we'll have to look into the future. How to help them? How to give them support, assistance? And that also through the social service ministry, we've developed certain programs to get them self-engaged into work where their home front can support them, where they can work from home. There had been different thoughts for it, and there had been different, you know, views which have come up how to support this. So engage the young, school leaving undergraduates or graduates who are in the verge of finding an employment, to make themselves counselors, direct them, put them into societies, get the society boomed with what the thinking should be. Not to narrow it down, okay, fine, we failed, we've encountered this COVID, we are a developing country, we cannot come over now, we'll have to live like this for the rest of the years. No, it's not that. Then again, the psychosocial problem goes not only into those sectors, into people who have been having a lavish life. Their part of interaction is lost. It is eroded. Their part of human touch is lost, which had caused a lot of damages, a lot of misunderstandings. So these things has to be streamlined. Then again, which comes is another important factor. I always tell this. In this COVID, if you have to overcome, if you have to win something, three factors predominantly affects. Number one, the state. What does the state do? How does the state support? And supporting actors, the lateral actors, lateral economic actors, or the supporting economic actors, like non-governmental organizations, the philanthropists, or you can take the leading business entities which have been functioning in this country, supporting in a greater way, giving their properties into the treatment centers. That was a huge move. So they have come out with innovative suggestions to complement the government actions. That's number one. Number two is the public. What you do. You've been served in a plate and given. It's your duty to eat. And how do you eat it? How well you maintain it? How well you clean it up? Third and foremost is the responsibility of the media. A lot of misinformation, a lot of disinformation has been circulated around digital, printed and social medias. So one should be very watchful and careful what to take and what not to take, and media should also hold their responsibility of overcoming this crisis in this nation.
Absolutely, and three very vital areas that you touched on there. And it all boils down to the individual at the end of the day. Not only our actions, but also our perceptions, our attitudes, our approach, what we do. And I guess this is where COVID has made us that much more conscious about our health, conscious about health in general. We've now realized that health is the real wealth. This is where we have to be investing. This is what we need to be looking at in the years ahead. So thank you very much, Dr. Hamdani, for sharing your views with us on the Sri Lankan Understanding, where we talked about life in a COVID-compatible world, how we are looking at moving forward. We've got to accept it. It's here. Whether we like it or not, we've got to deal with it. What are we going to do? It's entirely in the hands of individuals like yourself and myself. Thank you once again for joining us on the Sri Lankan Understanding. Join us again next time when we focus on another issue affecting Sri Lanka. And we look at the past, we look at where we are right now, and we look at the opportunity for the future.